Blackstone Audiobooks presents
Madame de Treymes and Two Novellas by Edith Wharton. Sanctuary, 1903. Part 1. Chapter 1. It is not often that youth allows itself to feel undividedly happy. The sensation is too much the result of selection and elimination to be within the reach of the awakening clutch on life. But Kate Orme, for once, had yielded herself to happiness, letting it permeate every faculty as a spring rain soaks into a germinating meadow. There was nothing to account for this sudden sense of beatitude, but was it not this precisely which made it so irresistible, so overwhelming? There had been, within the last 2 months, since her engagement to Dennis Peyton, no distinct addition to the sum of her happiness, and no possibility, she would have affirmed, of adding perceptibly to a total already incalculable. Inwardly and outwardly, the conditions of her life were unchanged. But whereas before the air had been full of flitting wings, now they seemed to pause over her, and she could trust herself to their shelter. Many influences had combined to build up the center of brooding peace in which she found herself. Her nature answered to the finest vibrations, and at first her joy in loving had been too great not to bring with it a certain confusion, a readjusting of the whole scenery of life. She found herself in a new country, wherein he who had led her there was least able to be her guide. There were moments when she felt that the first stranger in the street could have interpreted her happiness for her more easily than Dennis. Then, as her eye adapted itself, as the lines flowed into each other, opening deep vistas upon new horizons, she began to enter into possession of her kingdom, to entertain the actual sense of its belonging to her. But she had never before felt that she also belonged to it, and this was the feeling which now came to complete her happiness, to give it the hallowing sense of permanence. She rose from the writing table where, list in hand, she had been going over the wedding invitations, and walked toward the drawing-room window. Everything about her seemed to contribute to that rare harmony of feeling which levied a tax on every sense. The large coolness of the room, its fine traditional air of spacious living, its outlook over field and woodland toward the lake, lying under the silver bloom of September. The very scent of the late violets in a glass on the writing table, the rosy mauve masses of hydrangea in tubs along the terrace, the fall now and then of a leaf through the still air. All somehow were mingled in the suffusion of well-being that yet made them seem but so much dross upon its current. The girl's smile prolonged itself at the sight of a figure approaching from the lower slopes above the lake. The path was a shortcut from the Peyton place, and she had known that Dennis would appear in it at about that hour. Her smile, however, was prolonged not so much by his approach as by her sense of the impossibility of communicating her mood to him. The feeling did not disturb her. She could not imagine sharing her deepest moods with anyone. And the world in which she lived with Dennis was too bright and spacious to admit of any sense of constraint. Her smile was, in truth, a tribute to that clear-eyed directness of his, which was so often a refuge from her own complexities. Dennis Peyton was used to being met with a smile. He might have been pardoned for thinking smiles the habitual wear of the human countenance, and his estimate of life and of himself was necessarily tinged by the cordial terms on which they had always met each other. He had, in fact, found life from the start an uncommonly agreeable business, culminating fitly enough in his engagement to the only girl he had ever wished to marry, and the inheritance, from his unhappy stepbrother, of a fortune which agreeably widened his horizon. Such a combination of circumstances might well justify a young man in thinking himself of some account in the universe, and it seemed the final touch of fitness that the mourning which Dennis still wore for poor Arthur should lend a new distinction to his somewhat florid good looks. Kate Orme was not without an amused perception of her future husband's point of view, but she could enter into it with the tolerance which allows for the inconscient element in all our judgments. There was, for instance, no one more sentimentally humane than Dennis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.